the queer reality of Stonewall's own life and the lives of others in that period are unknown and remain absent from the history books.
I'm always amazed when I talk to people and they say, who's Stonewall Jackson? Or, I mean, they might know him from a sort of historical, you know, Civil War hero type context, but they have no clue what a powerful impact he's had on culture and art and music. I mean, the guy is everywhere. It's like, you know, when you learn a new word and then everywhere you look, there's that word. It's kind of like that with Stonewall.
As most scholars and students know, the period prior to the Civil War in the United States, certainly in the South, perhaps particularly in the South, was a time like that time before World War II in Weimar Germany, when there was a tremendous efflorescence of art and culture and a kind of growth of sexuality and a coming, pardon the pun, into one's own and others. And the experience of this for gay men in particular, and also, I must say, for lesbians, was an extraordinary sense of freedom.
You have to understand that Stonewall Jackson was the only open gay Confederate general. You know, all the men that went into the Confederate Army that, you know, thought they might be gay or at least enjoyed the promiscuity that was permitted within Stonewall's ranks sought him out in a very aggressive fashion. They had an impressive bond. I would say both physical, emotional, psychological. They were marching together. They were fighting together. They were sleeping together, and that was encouraged for, you know, morale boosting and as a way of keeping themselves physically and emotionally fit.
Though Stonewall Jackson did marry, and of course that gives a great deal of fuel to the deniers, the scholars and media folk who like to say that all of this is a hallucination, that in fact he was not queer. Though he was married, as a cover, obviously, his loving relationships and his sexual relationships with the men in his own unit were known everywhere, both in the military and out of the military. And interestingly enough, despite the Stonewall nickname and the fact that he was pretty ferocious in battle, the reputation sexually was often for tenderness, a kind of sweetness. People spoke of him in this way in their letters. Sometimes they wrote letters home to their pre-military boyfriends, the soldiers in his brigade, or to their younger brothers, even sometimes to sisters who understood their brothers' sexual identities. So we have this material in the archives talking about Stonewall Jackson visiting them late at night in their tents at the edge of the battlefield, ministering to them with fondness, affection, and sexual tenderness. All of a piece, what you would want in a romantic lover, right there on the battlefield. Really an amazing, amazing consideration.
Stonewall was very in tune with that, very in tune with his soldiers' needs, and he spent a lot of time, you know, in bed with, you know, those that were in need of comfort and warmth and love and, you know, release. You know, I mean, if the war were ended a different way, I imagine that, you know, that the South would look to that as one of the major strengths of their military in that time and one of the major things that set them ahead of the Union Army.
It's true that Stonewall Jackson's nickname is often a matter of humor. It was, in fact, related to his reputation for sexual prowess, for his ability to maintain a stone-like condition for an extended period of time. And there are many stories about why and how the nickname was first given to him. We needn't dwell on that. Nevertheless, clearly, the man was notable in that way.
They say the pen is mightier than the sword, and in wartime, a larger sword is mightier than a lesser sword. And Stonewall, according to all accounts, really, that I've been picking through, has had a mighty sword. And when he passed, there came a time where you know, where people would sort of think fondly of him, and you know, and they would try to honor him, and the way that they did that was by you know, miming, if you will, pulling a sword out of a scabbard, you know, pulling the sword out just like this. It was kind of like, and you would just hold it, you know, just you know, at, you know, right here, like you just hold it like that. So
anatomically, and of course, you may wonder how in the 21st century we may even speak of him anatomically, but strikingly enough, skeletal remains were actually discovered, which suggest that he did actually have a penis that was considerably larger than the average. And at one point, it was put into a granite box and buried under a monument in the western part of the state of Virginia, and was pointed, the place of burial was pointed out by tour guides until the end of the 19th and perhaps even the beginning of the 20th century. Those who did not believe dug up the box to say, oh, there's nothing there. They dug, they found the box, they found its contents. So this is information that we actually have. You probably know that there is great controversy about whether Robert E. Lee was straight or queer. I myself tend to fall to the side that considers him to have been straight, or mostly straight, certainly having a few homosexual experiences, as most men do, after all. I could be proven wrong on this. I have not found any truly convincing evidence. However, what I have found is that Stonewall had a tremendous affection for Lee, which is suggestive to me of some sexual nature, at least on his side, if not reciprocal, in the relationship. In his letters, Stonewall said these things, quote, "I never perform as well as I wish to when I am under Lee." And, quote, "Despite the positions I take with other men in this army, I am always, to my chagrin, beneath Lee." As well as, of course, Lee's personal note at the time Jackson was shot, saying that he wished that he could have been wounded instead, which is certainly not just the ordinary feeling of a commanding officer, but bespeaks a kind of actual affection. And as you all know, when Jackson died, Lee said, quote, "I am bleeding at the heart." Again, a serious depth of affection.
It's no coincidence that the actor Rock Hudson kept a lithograph print of him in his dressing room. I remember I heard an interview with Elizabeth Taylor some years after Hudson had died, and she it was a very affectionate, you know, remembrance. And she said something like, oh, Rock, he never went anywhere without his Acqua di Parma cologne and his Stonewall picture. So, I mean, the guy was everywhere. Yoko Ono had this show in New York City, and it was during a series that she was doing on sort of the mythologized hero, those mostly men who had been in place at various battles in various pieces of history. And this particular piece was called Hero, Not Hero. And it was interesting because it was a very simple setup. A small plaque next to the piece itself said, for SJ. There was a small little stepladder, and then hanging from the ceiling was a little sort of telescope-like thing. And so here's the plaque. It says, for SJ. Later in interviews, when she was pressed about who SJ was, she was very vague. It was very hard to pin her down, but I did read one time a line where she had said something like, let's just say Stonewall is an important man to know, something like that. And then she would never comment on that again after. So, I mean, we can guess Stonewall Jackson, SJ. But the interesting thing about this show was that John Lennon came. And John Lennon, maybe they had crossed paths, John and Yoko, at art gatherings, but this was the first time that they really connected, because here's what happened. He climbs up the stepladder, takes the telescope and looks through it, and what does he find but the word yes? It simply just says yes. And John Lennon is sunk. He is in love with Yoko Ono. And from then on, they're a pair, and everybody knows, you know, what happens later. And so I think, okay, yes, it's a stretch to say, but I would submit that Stonewall Jackson was there, at least in spirit, for the beginning of the end of the Beatles.
He was such a great lover of cosmic experience that he actually got to experience something that is so, so ultra-cosmic.
Another artist that I know held a candle to Stonewall Jackson and carried his photo around, apparently, or a photo of a sketch of him, was the artist Derek Jarman. And Jarman was a film director, known to be an amazing gardener. After he was diagnosed with AIDS, he moved to a little house that he made himself and lived and gardened. But before, when he still had good health, he actually pulled Laurence Olivier out of retirement and shot the film War Requiem. And that was Olivier's final performance. I mean, that was his last role. And so Jarman, you know, when you look at it from one angle, it's kind of like, what, this British director is carrying around this, you know, homage to a Confederate soldier from the United States. But when you start to study the connections, it becomes apparent. I mean, he directs music videos earlier in his career for Morrissey and the Pet Shop Boys. We will love the beach. Together. We will learn and teach. Together. Change our pace of life. Together. We will work and strive. Like a complete homage to men together marching in synchronized, crisp lines and working together intimately, kind of supporting each other, but also besting each other. There's this sort of interesting juxtaposition between rigor and support.
There are many folks of various generations, not necessarily those younger than I, who don't recognize the relationship between the naming of the Stonewall Inn, the Stonewall Brigades in every year's Pride parades, and Stonewall Jackson, the general in the Civil War, the Confederate general. And another reason that I wrote that book is that I want queer people to understand that it is absolutely appropriate for him to be a hero for his name through the inn and his own persona in history to be part of the history of the movement.
I think behind that story was the energy and the fierce independence and the stepping up that is so emblematic of Stonewall Jackson.
We have a long history, that history needs to be incorporated so that there is not just what happened in the 20th century with the Stonewall Inn, but Stonewall Jackson himself, a man whose own life is part of the history that our annual celebrations, and indeed our year-round considerations, need to take into account.
Oh, girl.